Hey guys, welcome back. Today we're back out at the range with the F&D Defense Invicta XAR rifle. That's a mouthful, but it is a rifle that has the ability to fold its barrel. We featured it here once before on the channel, and we just basically talked about the features and functionality of the gun in that original video and promised later down the road we would do a more comprehensive accuracy test and also a test of its return to zero capabilities. What happens when you fold the barrel and re-extend the barrel and shoot the gun? And that's what we're going to do this afternoon. This video is all about seeing what kind of groups this rifle can put down and what happens when you fold that barrel and re-extend it to the firing position. So here's the rifle. This is the XAR, and this is your folding barrel mechanism. It's very handy. It's somewhat lightweight. A lot of that has to do with the fact that it's using a pencil weight barrel. I'm pretty sure it's a Faxon barrel, but it does have a 223 wild chamber in it, so it is a match chamber that's in the rifle. We've shot it before, and with Federal Gold Medal match, this ammo right here, with its 69 grain projectile, we found that it can do MOA groups. MOA maybe even a little bit better, and I believe, yeah, this is a 1-in-8 twist on the barrel. So the 1-in-8 twist gives you a little bit of flexibility with your bullet weights. I know a lot of folks like 1-in-7, but in all honesty, I've tested the 1-in-7s and the 1-in-8s with various bullet weights from 55 grain all the way up to 69 grain and even heavier at times, the 77 grain OTMs. And really, I see very little difference in terms of accuracy between the 1-in-8 and the 1-in-7. So I know a lot of you guys worry about that. And there's a lot of fighting on the internet as to which one's better. Both, in my experience, perform about the same. All right, guys, so we're gonna start off by shooting a few groups. Now we've noticed, of course, this isn't the first time we've shot the rifle. We have noticed something that's interesting about folding the barrel and re-extending it while it's warm. And we'll talk about that here in a little bit. But right now we're just gonna get a baseline using the Federal 69 grain Federal Gold Medal match ammunition. We'll get that baseline, we'll break the action open, close it back up, and fire another group or two to show you how this weapon performs. So let's get started. I think you guys are gonna learn a lot of information today about the XAR. So first off, guys, always wear eye protection when you're shooting firearms. I'm not wearing it today because my old man eyes have a hard time seeing through the scope as it is. Adding a layer of glasses messes with me. They fog up and all sorts of stuff. I have a really hard time doing my best accuracy work with glasses on. So with that said, we have 3 rounds loaded of the Federal 69 grain ammunition into a Lancer magazine. And I'm gonna go ahead and insert that into the rifle. It's all locked in. And now we're just gonna fire our first baseline group, a 3-shot group, just to make sure that we have this thing shooting to point of aim. We have a zero on our little Casey's targets downrange. We have a whole bunch of them pasted up to an IPSC cardboard target, and it's being held by a challenge target stand. And with that being said, let's go ahead and make the weapon hot and fire our first 3-shot group. We'll start off on the bottom and work my way right. Okay, so yeah, we got about a 1-inch group going down there, maybe a little bit better. So it's shooting directly to point of aim. It's hitting dead center of that Casey's target. You got the shot dispersion, but it's all in that inner ring. So it's perfectly zeroed. Now what we're gonna do is take the magazine out. The weapon is cold, bolt's locked to the rear. I'm gonna leave the bolt locked to the rear. I'm gonna take my case. I'm just gonna stick it right here on the lever and push. That gives me all the leverage I need to break the action open. Okay, and you see how that little hook comes out? And now I can fold the rifle in half. Now I know what you guys are gonna say, what's the point of that, Mac, when you got that massive scope on it? Well, I don't run magnified optics on my rifles. If I'm shooting at the range and I'm trying to shoot for groups, I run magnified optics. And a fighting rifle, hunting rifle, things like that, I'm typically only using a red dot sight, or I'm using a really, really short scope, something like a L-can or something like that. But I'm a big advocate of red dot sights. Around here where we hunt, we don't have 500-600 yard shots on animals. We have 50 yards to 70 yards maybe, and it's more than enough to use a red dot sight. So that's, yeah. Plus this is on a QD mount if I want to take it off. All right, so now we got the weapon broken open. I'm gonna go ahead and load three more rounds into the magazine. I have one box that's open here. Now I'm gonna close. Now you'll notice that the rifle stays folded. It has a detent that you have to break open right here on the side of the receiver. We talked about this in the first video. It's really nice. And keep in mind, guys, this is designed to be a backpack gun, all right? Or something that's easily portable. Now I've closed that lever. I've returned the gun to the firing state. I'm gonna put it back on its rest here, get all set back up, and then we're gonna shoot the target directly right of the first target we just shot. All right, got everything all set up here. Weapon's unsafe, chambered around, and let's fire three more rounds and see what happens. I'm really resting this thing, guys, because I'm trying to take the human factor out of it. By the human factor, I mean I don't want to influence the rifle whatsoever. I'm trying to rest it, so all I'm really doing is pulling the trigger. All right, here we go, guys. Okay, so I'm gonna show you guys this. All right, so our left, right, and elevation is good, but the shot group went from one MOA to about like that. So what happened is we've got the rifle hot, firing the first three rounds through it. We folded the action, let's say, and then re-extended the action and fired another three shot group. Now we're still shooting to the same point of aim, but my shot dispersion is much larger. We've seen that many times before. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna load up another three rounds and shoot the target right next to it. All right, here we go, another three rounds. We're not opening or closing the action. We're just gonna shoot another three round group. Okay. And we'll shoot one more three round group. Then we'll run down range to take a look at the targets. All right, I'm going up one more row. Okay, point is made. Let's run down range and show you what happened. Okay, guys, here's what we did. This is the very first three-shot group we fired. All right, and we're gonna measure center to center on these rounds. A lot of people say, oh, you're not really measuring the true size of the group because you're not measuring the outside edges. Guys, bullets of different diameters, it wouldn't be fair. If I was shooting a 50 caliber round, which is a half inch in diameter, the edge of the group would be clear out here versus right here on 223. So you measure center to center as best you can. All right, we have the dial caliper here set, and let's see if we can get a group size. All right, that looks about center to center to me, eyeballing it, and that's a 0.72 inch group. Okay, so it's a sub MOA group. All right, now This is where we break the rifle down, load up three more rounds in the magazine, and then close it up, get it ready to fire, and fire three more rounds. One, two, three. Notice our left to right is good, and our elevation is still good, because if you look at the average size of this group, the center is still right about here. So we didn't move left, right, or up or down, but the shot dispersion went from less than an inch to this, which is considerably more than an inch. I'm just going to give you a rough idea here. This isn't going to be perfect, but we went to 2.9 inches. We went to a 3-inch group. Sub MOA, 3-inch group. Leaving the barrel extended, not breaking it down again, we fired another 3-inch group. Notice what's happening here. The groups are getting smaller, okay? So this was the next 3-shot group, and it's getting smaller. Let's get the diameter, I'm sorry, not the diameter, the distance here between the two furthest shots apart. Try to get middle to middle again here, or center to center. All right. There we have a 1.6 inch group, all right? So 1.6 inches, we came down from a 3-inch group to a 1.5-inch group. We've cut that group size in half simply by firing three more rounds. Then I fired one last group without breaking the action down again, leaving the barrel fixed. And this hole doesn't count. This was from us zeroing earlier this morning. Here's the three shots I fired in the last group. This hole and this hole look like they're the two furthest apart. Let's see if I can get a measurement here. Center to center. Yep, so these two holes are definitely furthest apart. Center to center. We're looking at 0.4 inches, 0.5 inches, 0.49. So a 1/2-inch group. Easily sub MOA. Sub MOA, 3 inches, 1.6 inches, sub MOA. Let's head back to the bench and talk about the effect that's causing this and why it's something you should think about if you purchase one of these rifles and what the purpose is for the rifle, how you intend to use it. Let's head back to the bench. All right, guys, so let's talk about what we just witnessed downrange. Our first group was sub MOA, and the gun is capable, obviously, of sub MOA accuracy with match ammunition, despite the fact it's running a pencil weight barrel. That's pretty impressive. Then we broke the action down, we folded the rifle, re-extended it, and fired a group. And that group opened up. The point of the impact did not shift whatsoever. It's still shooting to the same point of aim, but we went from a sub MOA group to about a 3-inch group, 2.9 inches. So the group opened up, and why did it open up? Well, let's look at that next group that I fired. The next 3-shot group I fired came back down to about 1.6 inches, or roughly half of the group I fired previously. The groups are getting smaller again. And then I fired one more 3-shot group, and we got less than a 1/2-inch group out of 3 shots, 0.4 or something. Let's just call it a 1/2-inch group. So we start off sub MOA, we fired two more groups after we broke the action open and closed it, which went to 3 MOA, 1.5 MOA, and then back to sub MOA, 1/2-inch group. Why is that happening? Well, guys, here's the one thing that makes this interesting about the Invicta AR. On a cold barrel, on a cold rifle, fold it, extend it, do all you want. It's going to go back to zero, and it's probably going to shoot sub MOA if you're using match ammunition, at least an inch, but in my case, it's usually sub MOA. It'll shoot those groups, and then you get the gun hot, and if you fold it while it's hot, and then re-extend it to start shooting again, heat tension becomes a factor, all right? So here we have, this is where the gun locks up into the receiver. When this is steel, we have some aluminum and stuff like that in there. We have different metals. When metal gets hot, it expands, right? When you fold this rifle when it's hot and go back to put it back in its place and latch it down, that heat tensioning is going to cause this to be slightly off until things settle back down. Firing the gun gets all these parts expanding, contracting momentarily in milliseconds, but it starts to bring the gun back to its true zero. That's why we saw a sub MOA group. Then we broke the action open, closed it up. Heat tensioning took effect. And we saw a 3-inch group, 1.6 inch group, and then back to a 1/2 inch group. And that's because the gun was settling in on a hot barrel. It's important to point out, when this rifle's cold and you fold the barrel, it's going to shoot sub-MOA to the point of aim. And then when you're done shooting for the day, you fold it, put it away, take it home, whatever. The next time you come back out on a cold barrel, on a cold gun, and refold it, it's gonna go back to shooting to point of aim and being in that MOA range. The only time it's not is if you're out the range firing, folding, firing, folding, firing, and folding. Then you're gonna have to fire a few rounds to settle the gun in or just let it cool off. So the gun is designed to be a backpack or very transportable gun. And it's not necessarily designed to be something that you go out and just fire, get it really hot, fold it, extend it, fire it, get it even more hot, fold it, fire it. That's not what it's intended for. It's intended for going out to the range, shooting, when you're done, folding it up, sticking in a backpack, whatever, going home, and it maintains zero. So that's what is going on. I thought it was interesting to point out is that heat tension between the barrel. But when this gun is cold or on a freshly shot barrel, after you get a couple of shots down range, the gun settles into a MOA or better rifle. And getting MOA or sub-MOA half-inch groups out of a gun like this is pretty darn impressive. Just be cautious or just know about that heat tensioning. I don't know too many people that are gonna keep breaking their gun down and folding it and extending the barrel at the range unless they're just trying to show their friends the cool factor of having a folding rifle. In a practical sense, you're gonna shoot it, put it away, and it's gonna get cold before the next time you shoot it again and extend the barrel. I hope you guys learned some interesting information about the F&D Defense Invicta XAR rifle. I know that I certainly did, but I've shot the rifle for a little while now. The rifle with its 1/8 twist pencil weight barrel does pretty darn good. Keep in mind, guys, this is not intended to be a match rifle. This is a pack rifle. It's meant to be lightweight and give you good accuracy and reliability in a package that you can basically fold in half. You do that, and now you have a rifle that's folded in half. I wouldn't run this particular rifle with this magnified optic. We've only put that glass on here for our accuracy testing this afternoon. I'd run this gun with a minimalistic MRO or something like that, a red dot sight, put it in a bag, stick it under the seat, make for an outstanding truck gun. If you live in a state where you can use 5.56 for hunting, some states allow it for deer, this would make an outstanding pack rifle. We also learned something interesting about the mechanism itself. So when you fold this barrel, when the gun is hot, you fold it and then bring it back out, re-extend the barrel, and start shooting while it's hot, you'll notice that your point of impact doesn't shift whatsoever. Not at all have we ever seen point of impact shift with this particular gun, but we noticed the shot dispersion opening up. And that's that heat tensioning going on inside of the rifle. When it's hot and you fold it, you bring it back, those metals are expanded, and as they start to contract, they will start to settle back in. Or as you heat the gun up, they'll start to slip and everything will start to line back up. So we noticed that when we folded it when it was hot, the dispersion was, you know, like 3 inches, but then it worked its way back down to MOA accuracy or so. But that's awesome out of a pencil weight 1/8 twist barrel. So overall, the rifle's nice, lightweight. It works very, very well, and I'm actually quite impressed with it in terms of a pack rifle, lightweight rifle, truck gun, lightweight hunting gun, because of its functionality of folding that barrel. It's a very robust system compared to other stuff that's on the market that I've tested. Now, the real problem, right? The price. These things are over $2,000, and I understand that, especially in this economy. The good news is the guys over at F&D Defense are working on selling just the upper. So you have the barrel, their hinge mechanism, and the receiver, and that probably will come in right around $900 or so, I'm guessing. I don't have final pricing on that, but I do know that it is coming, and the pricing will be much lower than buying a complete rifle. So now you can marry it to whatever lower you want to. Overall, fun gun to shoot. And I do like it, and you'll probably see it again here on the Military Arms Channel in the future. Guys, if you want to support us, we have our own shirt line now. Yeah, does this rifle take Glock mags? No, it doesn't. But you can pick up a Does It Take Glock Mags t-shirt over at forgefromfreedom.com. We've partnered up with those guys. I do have a link down below. And it's a great way to support the Military Arms Channel. We wear a lot of those shirts on our videos, and we'll continue to do so in future videos so you can see kind of some of the goofy stuff we come up with. Great way to support us. Another great way to support us here is to consider coming by and becoming a Patreon subscriber. Over at Patreon, we answer all of your private messages and emails. We post outstanding amazing deals from Copper Custom. I mean, prices that are ridiculously low on really, really cool products. As a thank you to you guys, we also post behind the scenes information and pictures. I do blog posting, political commentary, things like that, that only our patrons have access to. And plus, Freedom Munitions also does $100 ammunition giveaways, two of them. So every month we get to pick two lucky patrons to give $100 worth of ammunition to. Free ammo, pretty cool stuff. And we thank our friends over at Freedom Munitions for doing that. And another great way to support us here at the channel is just to swing by and check us out at Copper Custom. It's coppercustom.com. And we're got a lot of great people over there at Copper. If you ever come by, you're in the area of Valparaiso, Indiana, we have an open storefront. Please, guys, come on in. If I'm there, I'll personally shake your hand and hand you a free patch for coming by. We love our audience, and we really appreciate all the support you guys have given us over the years. So thanks again, guys, and we'll talk to you guys soon.